Brad, it's Friday afternoon at the Kellett house, and a large package arrives. It's very heavy.
Yeah.
It's got a lot of priority mail tape on it, and it's from Brad Geiger.
Yeah.
It's from Brad Geiger to the Kellett house, and I was like, what is this little treat? What could this possibly be? And I open it up, and it's the heft of it, it's about 30, 40 pounds, something like that, and I open it up, and it is filled chock-a-block with Legos, my friend, from Brad Geiger to the Kellett household.
Yeah.
So this is an incredible gift because your kids are older than mine. Tell me what, because I know this feeling. How wonderful is it to be past the stage of a toy where you can get, like, go with God, go to another house.
Yeah.
Well, get out of here.
We're doing a major home renovation this fall. And so it's literally going to mean we're going to have to move out of the house for a couple months because of all the stuff that's going to be going on there. And so we're encouraging our kids to pare down and get rid of stuff they're not using anymore. Clothes, toys, all kinds of stuff. And our younger son had kind of become the beneficiary of all of the Legos that had been passed down through the years from the time where his older brother had played with them and outgrew them. And he's still got some Lego stuff, but it's like the AT-AT that's put together and Doctor Strange's Sanctum Sanctorum. But he's got buckets and buckets and buckets full of Legos that are just loose parts that he was like, you know, I'm really never going to use. I'm not going to put something together, you know. It's
right.
And he's like, okay, I'm comfortable getting rid of them. And so we're like, well, we could take him to Goodwill. There was a couple different places. But then I remembered that your kids were really in that phase. So I'm like, hey, do you want 30 pounds of Legos?
And the answer was yes. It was an enthusiastic yes.
Yeah, and it felt so good to get them like out of the house and to know that they weren't getting, you know, thrown into a landfill or something dumb like that, that another kid was going to be able to enjoy and love them. And so I really didn't put too heavy a hand on this because I know getting rid of the Lego pieces was one thing, but my younger son, Max, was still really into minifigs. And if he goes to a comic convention, he always comes home with two or three Lego minifigures. But I'm like, you know, if there's a couple minifigs you've got doubles of or something like that, you know, there's no harm in throwing that in. And
well, speaking of doubles.
Maybe. Go ahead.
Speaking of doubles, I want to tell you that the generosity came through because not only did he get rid of the minifigs and pass them along, we, Brad, got five different Tony Starks. So the generosity did come through. And here's what's beautiful about it. We were talking about it as a family, and we're like, what do we do with five Tony Starks? I was like, mark one, mark two, mark three, mark four. That's what we do. These are all different Iron Men. This is like the different versions.
And I just found the gray suit Iron Man, the very first one downstairs in the laundry room. So I might throw that in an envelope and complete your set.
That's amazing. So we'll have the Mark 42. We'll have the Mark 1. That'll be great. Anyway, I just want to say kudos to your family and thank you because what generosity to pass that along. Legos, as a parent, by the way, Legos are like one of the few guilt-free toys that you can give your kids in the sense that like you're going to play with them for a decade. And then when you're done with them, they can absolutely be passed along because they're probably in fine condition, you know?
Exactly. Yeah, well, we had saved all of our Thomas the Tank Engine stuff from when the boys were little, with the idea that we would pass them along. And then when we got a little nephew, we kind of talked about it. And then it was like, some of that stuff, it was all wooden with paint. The paint was starting to chip. There was some reports that some of the paint have been toxic. So I was like, maybe we'll just hold on to those for a little while longer. but so we never were able to pass that along. But Legos, absolutely. You can pass those along and pass them along. Just think, Dave, someday you'll have maybe 60 pounds of Legos to send somebody. My 30 and your 30.
Well, honestly, though, I have Legos, and this is no joke, from when I was a kid, and they're still fine. They still lock into place. Like, Lego does a really good job, not to nerd out here, but they do a really good job of making a consistently quality toy.
Yeah.
Boy, that sounds like a commercial. What? That's
funny. Consistently quality toy. Listen to you.
Well, speaking of consistent quality, it's time for me to say hello, everybody, and welcome to Comic Lab, the show about making consistently quality comics.
And making consistently quality living from a webcomic. Oh, I thought I had that one nailed. I'm Brad Geiger, editor of webcomics.com and cartoonist of Evil, Inc.
And I'm his friend who's worried that he might be day drinking, Dave Kellett, cartoonist of Drive and Sheldon and co-director of Stripped.
And this week's Hour of Comics Advice is made possible by your support at patreon.com/comiclab. So Dave, let's talk comics.
Let's talk comics, my friend, and something very specifically exciting, comics pins. Ooh. Brad, we've got big news this week for everybody at Comic Lab. So we've created our first two pins from the podcast itself, not from Evil Inc., not from Sheldon, not from Drive, not from Cape Carnival, not from any of our projects. It's from Comic Lab specifically. And they are ready to go right now. They're on sale on Brad's store and on my store. Brad, you want to tell them what we have so far?
So we've got the first pin is a against all advice that we've given. The first pin is a Comic Lab logo pin, and I'm gonna totally take the hit on this one if it flops. It was something I wanted in the worst way. Dave designed that logo, and I think it's freaking beautiful. And I'm like, how can everybody not want that pin? So the first one is a Comic Lab logo pin. That's a beautiful enamel pin, and the other one says, ask me about my so-so art. If you remember, Dave was talking about being at a comic convention, and somebody came up and said, "Oh, you're really making a go of it with good writing and so-so art." So it's got a really nice, how would you describe that? It's a pencil that kind of curves its way through the words and says, ask me about my so-so art.
Yeah, and kind of a flowing banner way. The pencil becomes a flowing banner that says, ask me about my so-so art.
Yeah.
And so we wanted to do this for Patreon backers of the show because we are incredibly appreciative of the fellow question askers and listeners that back us on Patreon. So the pins are $10 each on our sites. But if you are a Patreon backer, there's a special link over at Patreon, a secret link, where you can get both pins for $10. So you're basically getting a free pin, a free Comic Lab pin for backing the show via Patreon.
Yeah, and it's the neat thing about that is that let's say you become a $5 backer because you want to also be able to ask a question during the show. That's if you become a backer for 2 months, you've made your money back on that $10 pin that you got for free. Right. So you basically get a free membership. Yeah.
Look at it this way. If you become a $5 member of Patreon for 1 month, you have stolen $5 from Brad and I. Oh. And we are OK with that. That's fine.
We're absolutely perfectly fine with that. And what a sweet, sweet reward that is to steal $5 from Dave and Brad. You'll probably want to take that and frame it.
Yeah, that's like one of those, you know, like I went to Wall Drug in South Dakota or whatever it is. You want to get a sign that says, I stole $5 from Brad and Dave. So if you are a Patreon backer of any level, you can get the both pins for $10, and you can get them at either Brad's store or my store. And here's what I would like to suggest. If you are a reader of mine, a Sheldon reader, a Drive reader of long standing, you came into this podcast as a basically a fan of Dave, I would love you to go over to Brad's store and buy from him rather than buy from me. It's a great way to try out something new. It's a great way to support Brad. So his URL is newevilbook.com, and you can get one of the pins for each one of the pins for 10. Or if you're a Patreon backer, you'll get the secret link by a Patreon to Brad's site that'll have both pins for 10. So that's my suggestion, is if you are a Sheldon or a Drive reader, go try out something new and support Brad over at newevilbook.com.
Yeah, and while we're at it, I want to talk to the Evil Inc. readers out there, both of you. If you are a... If you're an Evil Ink reader, likewise, I want you to go over to Dave's store and pick up your pins there. And while you're at it, check out some of the books that he has available over there. I get a Sheldon collection, get one of those pug books, or really treat yourself to one of those drive books. And I guarantee you're going to love it. And to do that, you go to SheldonStore.com. And you can pick up one or both of the enamel pins, throw a little something extra in for yourself. And again, if you're a Patreon backer, you'll get a special link that tells you how to get that extra pin for free. And that, by the way, that's just another way you can consider that that $10, you can consider that a way to splurge a little extra money on a Sheldon book.
There you go. Well, and since we're talking about becoming possibly a Patreon member, let me just remind everybody what you get when you join Patreon. So not only do you get the show a week earlier on a special feed that you can plug into any podcast app, we also have 30 hours of exclusive podcasts that have been recorded just for Patreon called ProTips. And there's some special shows in there, too, called Writer's Room, where Brad and I, we take you through the process of how we write, how we pitch to one another, how to up a joke and refine a joke and whittle it down and edit, which is also incredibly helpful. 30 hours of that exclusive show. At the $5 and up level, you can pitch questions to the show. At the $10 and up level, you can do audio questions to the show. And then in general, for all backers, you have access to the Discord server, which is this really thriving community of professional and pro-am cartoonists sharing tips and tricks and helping one another out. It's an incredible community. And all of that when you become a Patreon backer. So this is a great opportunity with this pin offer to jump in on the show.
Absolutely. This is your chance. And this is your chance to see really the enamel pin process that we've talked about on the show. You can see that in action. You can see the final product, how it looks, how it ships. You can really get in and see for yourself how that whole thing works that we've talked about on the show.
And we'll probably mention the pins again next week. But just a reminder, you want to go over to newevilbook.com or sheldonstore.com. Or if you are a Patreon backer, look for the secret links where you can get both pins for $10 over at patreon.com/comiclab. And Brad, to start off this week,
I just had a brainstorm. I don't mean to interrupt you, but I've got a brainstorm.
All right.
Then when you get your pin, take a picture of yourself with the pin and at us, you know, send it to us and tag us on Photoshop or Photoshop. God, old man Geiger, take a picture and at us on Twitter, so we can see you wearing your pin out in the wild.
What's funny about that? Now that you planted the image of old man Geiger, this is what it sounds like. Send a picture to Grandpa. Grandpa loves it when you send pictures. Put your pin on that I got you for your birthday and send me a picture. Oh, I love to see your faces. I miss you.
Well, I do. I want to see our listeners and our question askers out at comic conventions or out at festivals or just out at their drawing boards and tablets. If they're sidled up to their Wacom tablet, I want to see them with a Comic Lab pin on. And yeah, I would be delighted to see stuff like that.
Well, I co-sign that by saying, I want to pinch all your cheeks. So please send us photos. Oh, I'm so sad that I live far away in Michigan. Oh, I wish I was there to pinch your cheeks. All right, so Brad, now we're going to get to it. We have a call-in question, Brad, this week. And this is fun. At the $10 level and up, you can send an audio question into the show. And so let's hear it right now.
Brad and Dave, this is David, and I am the question asker. So when you both are working on your long form comics, how do you decide how many characters to add to your story at the beginning? And I know there's simple answers I've heard of as many as needed, but how do you boil those down to the core characters? How do you decide when to add to those core characters as a group? And then when do you have characters leave and join the story? Is it just kind of on the fly, or is that more purposeful when you're doing it? I like to start off a story of my own, and I'm having a problem trying to keep it down to enough characters to tell a story, but enough to keep it interesting as well. Love the show, and thanks a lot for listening to my question from the question asker.
All right, Brad, so that's a great one to jump in on, and I feel like you have a good one up on this one. So why don't you jump in on this one first? How do you decide how many characters to have, what their core competencies and their core failures are, and what they bring to the group or don't bring to the group, and how do you winnow them down or add to them? Go, Brad Geiger, Philadelphia, PA, go.
This is a fantastic question. And the answer is, of course, as many as it takes to tell the story, but that's a cop-out, as he rightfully kind of points out, is that if we were to just say, well, you know, like your English teacher did when they were assigning an essay, and you'd say, how many words do I need to make this essay? And they'd say, as many as it takes to get the idea across. And you'd be like, that doesn't help me at all. Give me a frame of reference. So it's a cop-out to say as many as it takes. So let's talk about how do you determine how many it takes. Chances are you're going to have probably more than you need. I'm going to assume that's where we're going to start from, because let's face it, if you start out with a cast of two, you're not worried about having too many, right? Let's start from the assumption that you probably have a few too many. So what you want to do is take your first maybe week or two worth of storyline or week or two worth of strips, and first of all, take your lineup, take all of your cast members, and like we've talked about on the show in the past, write down a few key defining background characteristics about who they are as a person. Right? Give me a little personality. And there's so many ways to do this. You could try to boil their personality down to one phrase or one word. Something that I do is I take a character that I'm very familiar with from popular culture, and I'll just use that name. It's, you know, it's something like B. Arthur from the Golden Girls, right?
Right.
Or something like Han Solo, you know. So it's not that I'm trying to write a Han Solo character, but that's my shorthand. In my mind, when I hear Han Solo, a certain set of traits click into place for me. So I use that as a shorthand. So have all of your characters and do that little bit of work in the beginning to decide, okay, who are these characters? And then go through the dialogue of that first couple of weeks that you planned out and ask yourself for each dialogue, as each character is talking, could someone else deliver this line?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And if you answer yes to that question for the same characters over and over again, and by the way, this is how I started to refine Evil Inc., because I realized that a lot of my characters were interchangeable. And I'd have a line, and it's like, okay, Mismatch said that, but Lightning Lady could have just as easily delivered that line. Desdemona could have easily delivered that line. That told me two things. Number one, I needed to make their personalities much, much more well-defined. And it told me when I rebooted the comic back in 2012, I needed to get rid of a lot of characters because they were all overlapping.
Right.
They were totally that I had two mad scientists. Okay. One of them had to go. Because you don't need two mad scientists. They're the same guy. And so one of them got ushered out in the reboot, and one of them stayed. And that's how I did it, is I started going through my dialogue and asking myself for each one, could somebody else say this? And if the answer was yes, it told me I had problems I had to address. And I addressed those in two ways. Number one, by doing a better job of defining who each of those characters were, and number two, by getting rid of characters that were extraneous.
Yes, and also extraneous. So those two things, both extraneous. I think extraneous is having an extra butt. Is that what that is? You have two butts?
Yeah, well, that's an upcoming storyline for After Dark. We're not going to go there.
First of all, I think Brad is right. And Brad really hit on a key thing, which is if a line can be delivered by more than one character, that's a problem.
Yeah.
It's both a problem, and I think Brad would agree with this, it's both a problem from the too many character standpoints and maybe also from the clarity of writing standpoint. So that's another thing we can talk about on a future day, which is a phrase from Charlie Brown has to be only from Charlie Brown. And if Schroeder can say it, then maybe it's not very good writing, you know? So anyway, but that's a different angle. But one thing that I like to do, let's talk about cognitive load for a minute. Now, your brain, a human brain, we evolved from being a hunter-gatherer kind of a species. And most of the time, we would have been in a group of 30 to 50 people, right? Not a lot of people when you think about it, but that was your core group. That's how many people you knew, you recognized, you could spot them, you could name them, you understood them, all that sort of thing. Now, in a modern society, we on a yearly basis interact with thousands of people, right? Each one of us, thousands of people.
Yes.
But think about it this way. When it comes time to invite people to your wedding, on average, a wedding is between 50 and 300 people, because really that's kind of the limit of people of how many you can know on site, care about them, love them, you know, cherish them in your heart. You're not going to be close, Brad, to 1,000 people. You're going to be close to about 150 people on average, right?
Well, that's cognitive load. And at $25 a plate, let's face it, you can only afford so many friends.
Right. That's exactly right. None of us are the Rockefellers here. Yeah. So what I'm getting at, though, Brad, and thank you for undercutting me with a joke. That's appreciated. No, what I'm getting at, though, is that if you are asking your readers to suddenly know and care about and want to follow a cast, don't make it huge. And that's what this question asker is intuiting, is that you can't make it huge because the cognitive load and the emotional load for any human being can only take in so much. You know, like, yes, Brad, I can understand and know all the cast of Star Wars. But if you also start to ask me to also know and care about the entire cast of Warhammer plus Dune plus this plus that, eventually my brain starts going, I'm going to remember the top three characters and everybody else can go shine it, you know?
Right, right. And if you do find yourself in a situation in which your cast is expanding, that's fair. In other words, your cast is going to expand as your universe and your storytelling grows. That's okay. And it's another reminder to start small, because it's inevitably you're going to have creep, right? As your storyline goes, you're going to be adding more and more characters, and that cast is going to creep outwards. It's a reminder that, number one, that's not a bad thing. Number two, some of those people are going to enter the orbit of your storyline only maybe once or twice a year. That's also okay, but it's a reminder to reintroduce them, to find different and creative ways to bring them back into the fold for the time they're going to spend in your orbit until they go. And that could be, you know, somebody else saying, oh, who is that person? Or, you know, having some other way for a stand-in for the reader to say, get me up to speed here. That's perfectly fair. And I wouldn't get upset if you're further down the line than this question asker and you see your cast creeping outwards. That's okay. It's just a reminder that you need to, reintroduce at times. And sometimes if you get back to that point where you've introduced a character who's become very, very similar to an existing character who gets more stage time, once they leave the orbit of the storyline, let them float out into space.
Right.
Maybe that person doesn't come back. Yeah, it was a good, you needed that person for a storyline, but they're much too similar to somebody else who already exists. Once they're out of orbit, let them float.
Right. And so let's talk for a brief second about how you winnow them down before you've even started. So one way that Brad and I have talked about in the past that I find very effective is try to reduce each character that you're proposing to one word. What is the, it can be a mood, it can be a tone, it can be an outlook on life, it can be the purpose that they serve to the story. So one character's emotional singularity might be the word control. Another one might be the word joy. Another one might be the word inward looking, or, you know, whatever phrase could be summarizing them in one word. Try to get it down to that, because if you find in summarizing two characters that their words are very similar, you might want to take a pause and go, well, wait a minute, do I need these two characters? If one character is creativity and another character is joy, is that the same thing? And if it's not the same thing, then explore for yourself as a writer why and how they're different and how you're going to differentiate those two things, you know, that kind of thing. Then another way to winnow it down, Brad, is the silhouette test. And this is a good one for maybe beginning artists that are, and this is separate from writing. This is about how they look and how they interact in the story. There's a lot of early cartoonists, Brad, and I'm sure you know them, in their first 1 to maybe 7 years, where if you were to silhouette their art designs, their character designs, if there's four women in the strip or four guys in the strip, all four of the pure silhouettes look exactly the same or so similar that a reader's like, I don't know which one's Cindy and which one's Marianne. I have no idea. They both look the same to me. Oh, I guess one is blonde hair and one's black. All right. Well, I'll figure that. That doesn't seem very clear, but
exactly
what I'm getting at there is that in the same way that socially it's awkward to try to remember two people that look very similar. It's awkward for a reader to go, well, wait a minute, who is this now? Is the one that hates cheese. Okay. Who's this? Oh, this is the character that's the vice president of the company. Okay. So make your silhouetted characters, make your character designs very distinctive, because that can come to haunt you. And then also, as you do the silhouette tests on them, you'll see, oh, these two characters are too similar. Maybe I just get rid of one of them.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you think, Brad?
Yeah. Oh my gosh, that's such, and you can, if you do silhouette test and cartoon in a Google image search, there's a bunch of examples of this. Like they have a bunch of cartoon characters all in one image, and you can tell the cartoon character just based on the silhouette, which tells you a lot right there.
Yep.
But like take a cast like SpongeBob, right? Those characters each have a very unique silhouette. And so when they walk onto the screen, there's no question who you're dealing with, and they're each very unique. And by the way, that's something that I still struggle with. Like as I was for the longest time, I was just having trouble getting an image on the paper or getting an image on the screen, right? Just getting somebody to look like a person. And so I gravitated towards certain body types, certain things that I could reproduce. And as a result, a lot of my cast kind of had the same body type.
Right.
I've had to try to move away from that and get to some different types and some different silhouettes, because I very much fell into that trap of the same silhouette trap. And to be, if I'm being completely honest, I'm still grappling with it. I'm still trying to kind of push some of those characters around. In fact, there was one character, Elastic Man, when I introduced him, had exactly the same silhouette as Captain Heroic, had the same hair, had the same nose. The only difference was a cape and no cape, right? It was complete. And it was one of those things that just one day, boom, he came onto the screen, completely different character. And just, I explained it with one punchline and then went on from there. Because it's like, this is way too close. I got to change this. And there's just going to be no easy way to do it. I ripped the Band-Aid off, explained it, and went forward. But that's, Dave's bringing up such a good point. There's a lot to be said for the visual homogenization that we can fall into, as well as the way we write it.
Yeah. So I think these are three good ways to look at your characters that you're proposing, question asker. One is the silhouette test. One is reduce everybody down to one word, their core being, their core essence, and see if anybody is frankly too similar. And then the third one is Brad's excellent idea that if a same line can be delivered by two very different characters and it means the same thing or, you know, it has the same delivery, then that's a problem.
Yeah.
And so I think those three techniques can help you start to winnow down. And then also my last thought is, have a look at every major cast production you've ever seen, and keep in mind that the most successful all have between 4 and 7 characters, and don't go far beyond that. Aside from, you know, ancillary side characters, the TV show Friends, the TV show Seinfeld, the Brady Bunch. You know, you can go down the list, because really, again, it goes back to cognitive load and how much a human mind can take in terms of a social awareness of other humans or characters. There's a quiet acceptable limit, and it's usually in that 4 to 7 to 8 range. And after that, people start going, "Wait, who is this?" And you feel it as a viewer or as a reader. You're like, "This cast is too big. I don't know who all this is."
Yeah. And I'm just going to step in because I know where this goes, because immediately somebody isn't going to hear like 5 words that you said in that sentence that were key. And they're gonna say, well, what about Doonesbury? Doonesbury has a cast of thousands. What about The Simpsons? It has a cast of thousands. What Dave said was they had that 5 to 7 was the core group of main characters, right? Don't please don't add us and tell us about Simpsons and Doonesbury. It boils down to who is the core group. There can be dozens and dozens and even hundreds of characters that orbit outside of that. That's fine. That's fair game. But what Dave's talking about there is a core group of your main characters, right?
Right, right. And you're always going to want somebody coming in for a little bit of flavor that adds a spice or puts a wrinkle on the story. So yes, side characters are always welcome to come in. They do their bit and then they exit stage left. But yeah, what I'm getting at there is, and frankly, Doonesbury does have too big a cast. Peanuts does have too big a cast, but it was also 50 years of Peanuts. So you got to give Schultz a little bit of credit there. He kept the core cast. And then, you know, did we need the fourth Snoopy cousin? I don't know. Who am I to say?
I'll say it. We didn't need him.
but let me tell you this. Have I cartooned for 50 years and had to keep finding new material? No. So God bless him. He did what he could. You know, he's like,
yeah,
I can imagine Schultz is like, I can't do it anymore. I can't draw one more Snoopy strip. Now there's a fourth cousin. There's a fourth Snoopy cousin. Here we go.
That's right. I need a dog that's going to talk to a cactus. And so Spike was born.
Yeah. I need a dog with an eating disorder that talks to cactuses and doesn't know how to shave.
Well, listen, Dave, I think we put a pretty good button on that now that we've denigrated poor Charles Schultz. So let's go to a news item that I pulled to talk about before too much longer.
Okay.
You ready for this?
Sure, hit me.
So the United States Postal Service, at the end of, I think, October, may leave the Global Postal Union.
Buh.
So this is, yeah, and as a matter of fact, and I'm quoting from a site called FreightWaves.com that follows the shipping industry. Quote, barring an 11th hour agreement, the U.S. Postal Service will leave the U.S. Postal Union on October 17th, ending 144 years of U.S. involvement in international body that governs the exchange of mail and postal parcels. They talked to a gentleman from iDrive Logistics who estimates the price increase of at least 300% for shipping internationally into the United States. Since the U.S. Postal Service will cancel negotiated service agreements covering international shipments, if the withdrawal takes place, U.S.-based international shippers will also pay more. In other words, it's going to cost, if you're doing books from overseas and shipping them over here using the United States Postal Service along the way, that's going to go up. If you're shipping books from the United States to overseas, it's not going to be as drastic as that 300% increase, but it's also going to go up. And chances are it's going to go up significantly. So this is a really good time as you're planning out the end of the year and particularly any book or any merchandise that you're doing whatsoever in 2020, you need to keep that on your radar. And until we find out what exactly that price hike is going to be, this is a good time, in my opinion. This is one of the things, and there was a couple things. But this is one of the reasons that I quietly shelved the Kickstarter that I was planning for 2019, because number one, it had gotten too close to the end of the year and I didn't want to carry money into the next tax season. And I saw that and I'm like, well, that settles it. I'm not moving until next year when I can see how those prices shake down, because I could be way off in my estimate. And so the decision I made for myself was to put it on the shelf until we see how that shakes out. Now, at this point, I want to mention something, because Indicia, do you remember Indicia, Dave? They were our first sponsors for Webcomics Weekly.
Yeah, well, this was like a decade ago, right?
Way, way back. Yes. Yeah, at least a decade, if not longer. And what they are is they're a desktop shipping solution. You can print your own postage, get all, you know, weigh your stuff, post it out, and you can either have the United States Postal Service pick it up at your location, or you just drop it off at the post office, and it's all paid for. You don't stand in line, drop it off, and off it goes. And Decia, after this news came out, put out a press release in which they said that no, basically, and I'm paraphrasing here, no matter what happens with all of this, they have a what they call a newly introduced global post international service, which is not reliant on the U.S. relationship with the Universal Postal Union. Quote, our network leverages partnerships with international postal operators as well as commercial carriers, and they're going to keep their prices. They're not they word it very carefully. It's not guaranteeing that you'll pay the same prices, but they're intimating that any price increase is going to be much lower than anything you're going to be paying right there at the post right. office. So, a few things to keep on your radar. Number one, shipping is most likely going to go up after the administration pulls the post office out of the postal union. That's very likely to happen. And number two, if you don't have a shipping solution like an Indicia, for example, I'm sure there are others. I'm just familiar with Indicia, so they're on our radar. That may be your best bet to keep your shipping prices lower than they would be otherwise. What do you think, Dave Kelly?
Well, yeah. So I want to say Brad had said that prices may be going up, and I want to say that prices will definitely go up no matter how this shakes out. If the U.S. pulls out of the postal union, prices will definitely shoot up very high. If the U.S. Stays in the postal union, that means they probably won their argument. And so their prices will go up both to ship to and from the United States internationally. I have to say, this is it's unfortunately bull in the China shop kind of way of dealing with this. But it is weird mm-hmm. that packages from Shenzhen or Guangdong are cheaper to ship to New York than from Los Angeles. And that's weird. So that did need to get fixed. It's just this is a shitty way to do it. The bottom line is, if you're Dave Kellett and you launched a Kickstarter with certain set prices for your shipping, and in December you're going to have to actually ship these products, you're screwed. So congratulations to everyone named Dave Kellett who just Kickstarted a book with certain set prices for shipping. You did great. Yikes. You did great, champ. You did the best you could with the information you had at the time, and you're just going to have to swallow the huge loss in shipping prices that you're going to have to pay in December, and you're screwed.
Ask me about my so-so business decisions.
I mean,
although you can't even say that. This was not a decision that you made. This is just basically a storm that popped up on your horizon that you got to deal with.
There's been
now.
Four storms business-wise. It's like, oh, tariffs. Yep, I'm going to have to deal with that. Oh, shipping prices pulling out of the postal union. Going to have to deal with that. So big reminder, everybody, vote in 2020.
Yeah, it's definitely having a pronounced impact, and right now your best bet is to educate yourself, keep yourself very very in tune with what's going on in terms of shipping prices.
Nimble,
and be ready to move quickly. And if you are planning a Kickstarter, my advice to you is pad those shipping prices a little bit. And protect yourself, because you really don't know what's going to happen in the next few months. I don't think anybody knows what's going to happen. But if this person from iDrive Logistics is right, we could be looking at a 300% increase in certain instances. Now he was saying from overseas to the United States. Now, like when I have my books printed overseas, I don't know that the United States Postal Service is involved with bringing those in. But there's also the ripple effect that after those prices go up, then other entities have the ability to raise their prices because they're in competition with the postal service. So it can have a knock-on effect. Even if you're not using USPS specifically, this thing could have a ripple effect throughout the shipping industry, in my opinion. So keep your eyes open in the next few months. Keep very, very close tabs on what's going on.
Hey,
If you're listening while you work, take a minute and stand and stretch.
And while you're doing that, Brad and I are going to tell you why you should join us on Patreon.
Yeah, because, you know, when you do, you'll get hours and hours of podcasts that we've recorded just for backers.
And an exclusive Patreon post that go even deeper on the Comic Lab topics.
And access to our exclusive Discord server, a thriving community of professional cartoonists.
So you can support the show you love and get tons of actionable resources for your own cartooning.
And listen, if you can't swing a pledge this month, no worries.
You can still support the show by rating us wherever you get podcasts.
Leave us a 5-star review and a few kind words.
And that, along with mentions on social media, is incredibly helpful.
And now, let's talk comics. So, Dave, I've got another topic that I want to talk about. I'm full of questions and thoughts today, in case you haven't noticed.
Full of something, yes. All right.
Yeah. So I wanted to talk about line weight a little bit today. And specifically, okay. I see a lot of webcomics. I follow a lot of comics. And there is, I don't know why, but it's just really been on my radar for the last couple of weeks, the difference that line weight makes in a professional appearance. And specifically, I want to talk about the importance of varying your line weight, having some very thick lines, having some very thin lines, and knowing when to use the two. For example, you can use a thin line to indicate where the light is hitting and to kind of indicate a highlight on the thing that you're drawing. In the same way, you can use a heavier line to indicate a shadow. It's also very nice to have heavier lines form the outline of your shape and to have lighter lines form some of the details and to have some variation within those zones as well. Like not all of the detail lines need to be super light. You can have some heavier lines in there as well as you're thinking about the interplay of shadow and highlight. But what happens is if you don't do this, if you're just using the same weight of line throughout your entire illustration, or maybe if you just have like one kind of heavy line and one kind of lighter line,
right,
you end up
right.
with what I call coloring book art, right? It looks like it's
yeah,
only
that's a good
there.
Way to describe it, yeah.
Yeah, it looks like it's only there so you can color inside the lines, you know?
Right.
And there's so much of that coloring book line art out there that I want to really encourage our listeners to vary their line art. And I wondered if you had any thoughts on that, some advice on doing better in that regard.
Well, yeah. So 101 kind of stuff, for those not familiar with the term line weight, that basically just means the width, the feel, the overall impression the mark making has on the paper. So when someone says like a thin line weight, that means it's a very narrow spindly line. When it's a heavy line weight, that's a heavier, thicker line. Usually has more of a brushy feel if it's a really truly heavy line weight. And and what Brad means there is that the line itself, before you introduce any color or texture or tones, the line itself can indicate where light is hitting, where the weight of an object falls, where the shadows of an object fall. And it's really helpful and instructive, especially if you're drawing black and white, to have your line weight variable to that. So like if I was going to be caricaturing Brad, for example, up by the hairline, I would use a very thin line, right, to indicate where the light is hitting. No other reason. I would just purely based on light.
Right.
It would be a very thin line.
And then when I get down, you'd want to see the light hitting off of that bald spot in the back is what you want to see.
Right. So you want a very thin line, really emphasis on the thin. And then
I get thin.
And then when I get down towards his backside, it would be a very thick and heavy weight line weight.
Wait a minute. How come you're caricaturing me completely turned around? What kind of a caricature is this? A lot of people, when they do a caricature.
That got me. So, and then when you get to the front of Brad, you're going to want a very thin weight. Like, you might want to switch pens. You're going to want to get a very thin weight.
Yeah. When you're caricaturing Brad from the front, you're going to want to use your eraser.
No, but anyway, all of that is to say that where the light hits, you want a thinner line. If you're drawing a even if it's a simple caricature or more iconic character rather than a realistic character. Even there, the line of switching up your line weight and you're varying your line weight makes it more interesting for the eye. If nothing else, it makes it more interesting for the eye. Because to Brad's point, having the same consistent line weight, now granted, there are styles like a Ziggy where the line weight is the same all the way across. But what that does, though, is it kind of makes it boring in the same way that a coloring book feels boring, in the same way that the IKEA instruction guy feels boring, because it feels like an engineer drew it rather than an artist drew it, you know?
Yeah, and it's flat. It's flat and lifeless. And for something like Ziggy, where it's not about any of the details, Ziggy is about economy of line. Ziggy is about getting that information out with the fewest lines possible. And that's fine if that's what you're doing. And that's valid. That can be very graceful and beautiful if you do it well. But if not... then you got to go back to thinking about the quality of line.
Yeah, and so when you're drawing even iconic characters, like let's compare two of these. If you look at like a Ziggy or a Dilbert, right? A very boring, plain, monotonous line. Now compare that to one of the people who I think has one of the best line variations in the business, Jim Borgman, who is an editorial cartoonist in the Midwest and also does zits. He has an incredible variable line that is really quite lovely. And and so just an example of like what the variation of line, both iconic characters, both very comic strippy characters, but Jim Borgman's variated line is delightful on the eye. Whereas Dilbert or Ziggy, you're like, yeah, here's another Dilbert, you know, that kind of thing. Like there's not a lot of variation there. You know what I mean? There's not a lot of life there in the drawing itself.
Well, and I don't think that's really taking anything away from either one of those strips either. I don't think Dilbert is about a pleasant image. It's about the writing. And that's perfectly fair.
Yeah, and I think that's perfectly fair. There's a lot of comic strips, maybe myself included, where the writing does the heavy lifting versus the drawing. But it's just something to aspire for. Like Brad, over the decades of drawing, have learned two things. One, varying up my line weight is helpful.
Yeah.
And also, I've also learned that messing up my line weight is helpful. And by messing up, I just mean, for me personally, my aesthetic has changed where I used to love and strive for a perfect line.
Yeah.
And I realized that the eye actually likes an imperfect line. It makes it more interesting. It adds a little zhuzh, a little character to it to have an imperfect line. And so now I actively seek it out. And I have to say I'm much happier with an imperfectly drawn line than when I used to strive for the gotta be so clean. I need it so clean.
Right,
you know,
right.
That kind of thing.
Yeah. And that takes a lot of the life out of your line.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I want to mention, because this is a great time to talk about our sponsor for Comic Lab, Wacom.
Oh, yeah.
At WACOM.com, who makes the Intuos and the Cintiq drawing tablets. My line improved 110% when I started drawing digitally on a Wacom Cintiq, because I could start to tweak my stylus sensitivity. I could start to experiment with different pen tips and brush types, and I could kind of force myself to do some different line weights and to some different variabilities, and using different sensitivity settings on the software I was using, like Clip Studio Paint, I could get a better line weight just using the same kind of motions that I was using for my line to begin with. It could exaggerate that a lot more if I wanted it to. The end result was my art looked way better after I started using a Wacom Cintiq.
Well, I will say this. I did not have as smooth a transition as you did, in the sense that when I went digital with Drive, the first maybe 3 or 4 strips, even to this day, look more lifeless, because and this is like a recurring theme of me going digital. It's like, daddy didn't read the instructions here, is that I didn't realize that there were sensitivity controls. And so I want to put an underline under that when you start drawing digitally, one of the things you want to fiddle with is how, because to Brad's earlier discussion about how much pressure he puts on it, the pressure that Brad uses on a digital pen is very different than what I use on a digital pen. And so for those reasons, you're going to want to adjust your sensitivity settings to where you fall on that spectrum. Like if Brad used my sensitivity settings, it wouldn't work for him. And frankly, if I use Brad's, it wouldn't work for me. So I had it all wrong when I first started, and it felt lifeless and comic coloring book style when I first did it. Yeah. So that's just something I want to underline, is make sure you fiddle with those settings, because God, it can make a difference in your digital drawing when you have the settings right. Oh, chef's kiss. Now I love it. I know exactly what range I work on under and best under, and I get a much better drawing out of it. But it's just something you should be aware of, that it's going to require a little bit of fiddling, don't you think, Brad, when you first start? But it's so worth it.
Oh, yeah. That's so true of anything that you do, whether you're talking about something like a Cintiq or whether you're talking about doing pen and ink with a brush. There's going to be a learning curve, and it's so easy to get frustrated and kind of rage quit that stuff within the first week and go, I'm not going to do this. I'm never going to be right. Have the perseverance. And I'm such a big fan of doing kind of like a do or die scenario when you do something like this. Like when I first decided I was going to switch from pen and ink to a Wacom Cintiq, I made the decision on Friday that Monday's comic was going to be digital. And I just disallowed myself. Once I crossed that point of no return, it was done. And it was like, okay, from this point on, I'm digital. Yep. And that forced me to work out all the problems as they come up. Listen, it was a horrible weekend. and that's not a mark against the software or the hardware. It was more between the chair and the hardware that the problem was, right? I had to work those problems out.
Like, but if you put yourself— My brain, Brad, I had to figure out what that construction was, but between a chair and a software. Oh, he's talking about Brad. Oh, Brad was the problem. Okay. Like I was over here going, wait, what's between the chair and the software? Oh, he's talking about Brad. He's talking about himself. Okay. All right. There we go.
You had to draw a little chart, huh? I'm a big fan of that scenario where you say, okay, I'm going to do this. Specifically, Dave, you've talked about Clip Studio Paint. I still think that's what it's going to take for you to make the switch to CSP, is just deciding one day, okay, this is what I'm going to do. There's going to be no turning back, and just suffer through that first couple of days and then go on from there.
Brad, as you know, I've said it often enough on the show, CSP is my white whale. Like that, I feel like I'm either going to die trying, or it's going to kill me out in the Atlantic somewhere. And I'm going to be screaming Moby Dick as I go down. But anyway, Brad, I want to ask you, because this is a perfect time, considering you want to try something new. A question has come in just for Brad this week, so I want to ask it. This comes in from Curious Board.
For me?
Just for you, Brad. I'm not involved. I want to make this very clear that this question is not for me, and I should not get involved. So this
is from Curious Borg.
Curious Borg says, "Hi guys, I know Dave wants to be in sci-fi and will soon be signing up for conventions, but Brad, he says, do you think you'd ever change genre, or does your heart really belong to comedy, superhero, adventure?" Brad, would you ever, considering you're just talking about change, would you ever change genres? Can you see yourself writing a Western? Can you see yourself writing a romance? Well, you do in a way. Can you, I'm trying to think of another genre. Can you see yourself writing historical fiction? Can you see yourself writing coming of age stories?
Oh, the answer is yes, yes, and yes. And it fits into so much that's been going through my mind in the last few months and even the last year or so. So first, superhero. Absolutely. At some point, Evil Inc., I've rebooted it once in 2016. And at some point, the relationships are going to get to a certain point at which I will have said everything I want to say about those characters, at least for the time being. Mm-hmm. And I do see Evil Inc. Coming to an end at some point, at which point I would be very excited to do any number of other projects, as long as it's not Westerns, because you are not going to catch me trying to draw a horse anytime soon. But yes, I am. And in fact, for After Dark, there was a space pirate storyline that I would really love the chance to do my version of a space opera and all that. And in terms of writing straight up humor, so we talked about on the show a little while ago that my wife turned me on to romance writing as through audiobooks, and that I've come to the conclusion that it's some of the best writing that I've read anywhere. I mean, I really, really have become enamored with romance writing. And it is so similar to what I do with Evil Ink and Evil Ink After Dark, right, that I'm starting to wonder whether I shouldn't be pivoting to a romance situation. In other words, there's a lot of my readers who they want me to do a book that combines Evil Ink and the Evil Ink After Dark counterparts. Like every now and again in Evil Ink, characters get to a certain point where I put a little note there, this is continued in After Dark, right? Because it would be inappropriate to continue it on Evil Ink. So I've gotten this request multiple times. I'd like a book that combines the two so that I don't have to have two books to follow that continual storyline. And the upshot is, between that and a very small tweak in what my focus is, would be a romance novel. It would very much be romance. So what I've been turning around in my mind an awful lot is the pivot of, at some point I may take on something that's not necessarily superheroes, and I may take on something that isn't focused 100% on the humor and is more focused on the romance and the relationship aspects that uses humor as a secondary component, but not putting humor in the primary spot as much as I had in the past. So the answer is yes, and stay tuned. I don't know when, but it is definitely something that I've been thinking long and hard about over the past year.
That's exciting. I say this as a friend. Yeah. I'm genuinely excited for you. So let me ask you this, Brad, because this will be instructive to me. How will you know when it's time to make that switch or when it's time to start the new project?
That's a great question. So for me, the two main characters of Evil Ink have always been Captain Heroic and Mismatch. The idea of a superhero who's in love with a supervillain, that's always been the main relationship in Evil Ink. And at the same time, as I started teaching a storytelling class at University of the Arts, I kind of challenged myself to do a hero's journey storyline. And right now, the story that just wrapped up at Evil Ink is basically 2/3 of a hero's journey story that's going to have a dramatic impact on that relationship. Once that is culminated, there's a good degree of storytelling that's going to happen after that. There's a lot of stories to be told, but it's kind of almost, I don't want to say the beginning of the end, but it's an indication that after that, things are going to start to change to the extent that I will find myself at the end in another couple of years. In other words, there are next steps in that. Eventually, it's almost like that sitcom thing where you've got two characters and you know they're going to get together, but the whole excitement is, when are they going to get together? How are they going to get together? And then finally, at some point in that sitcom, you've got to release that tension and let the two characters get together. Well, now they're in a relationship. There's a lot of storytelling to be told there, but then eventually they get married, right? And then they have a kid. And then that original relationship is very different than the one that it started out with. And things can get stale after a little bit, or not necessarily stale, but it's not the story that a lot of your readers signed up for. I feel like I'm filibustering here, but that was the reason that I rebooted in 2016, is that I realized I had started at the end of the story. Cap and Mismatch were married, they had a kid, and I missed out on all of that stuff that should have come first.
Right.
So eventually we're going to come full circle with that, and that's when I'm going to know it's time to launch something new.
Because I'm right now, and it's good to talk about, I'm in a state of confusion or anxiousness where, and I now know this feeling, I recognize this feeling. This is the feeling that comes 2 years to 6 months before I have a breakthrough or I have a new project that I'm really fired up about, you know?
Yeah.
So I know and I recognize, and I'm not trying to be down on myself, that right now I'm in a moment of readiness in the sense of like, I'm ready for the anxiety and the nervousness and the confusion to be over because I what I'm saying is I recognize that my state right now is the there's a thousand jumbling ideas that are waiting for the one clarity moment where all the ideas click and it becomes a project.
Yeah.
And that happened once before with Stripped, which became the documentary film that I made, right? Where I had all these jumbly thoughts and it was a sense of confusion for about 6 months until a conversation with Fred Schroeder, we went, aha, this is what we want to do. And then that same thing happened, that jumble confusion and anxious ideas that were in competition until all of a sudden at that one book signing where I go, aha, now I know I want to draw Drive and I know what the story is. Right now I'm in that stage of jumbling competing ideas that are trying to, you know, work their way into a story. And it's not a fun stage to be in, but I at least am now at peace with the fact that I know I'm in a moment of confusion that comes right before a breakthrough moment, you know?
Oh, and that's such a perfect thing to say.
And I know that sounds wishy-washy. I'm hearing myself say that out loud, and it sounds ridiculous.
No, it doesn't.
But it's part of what the creative process is you've got to churn up the field before you can plant those seeds, you know?
How many of our listeners have written in with questions or talked to us at conventions that say basically what they're telling us is they're in that spot that you just described, but because they don't have the experience that you've had, they think that their confusion and their gestation period, for lack of a better term, is an indication that they're not good writers, and they feel as if they should have written something by now, and they don't realize that that this is a natural part of the creative process. And what they need to do is not get frustrated, not get talked into, well, I'm just a bad writer because I haven't made this into a tapestry of beauty yet. They need to know that everybody faces what you just described. Everybody faces, and it can go on for 6 months. Think of how many people have given up because they were in month number four, and they thought, well, clearly I'm not meant to write anything. I haven't come up with anything yet. None of these jumbling ideas make sense. Listen to what Dave just said in that moment of genuine honesty. This is a 6 month process. And yes, he's got other things to work on as he's going along. But let's say he didn't do Sheldon. He wasn't doing Drive and he wasn't working on any mystery side projects or anything like that. What would he be? Well, he'd be in this same place trying to get one thing off the ground. And he's going to stick with it, and he's going to get that thing because this is a natural part of what creativity is. Sometimes you just sit and spin your wheels for months and months on end, and don't get frustrated. Don't get frustrated. The breakthrough is coming. You just got to stick with it. The biggest mistake you can do is what I see time and time again, where people are like, well, I've got to hit a deadline. I got to do something. So I'm going to start doing this thing. And they're like, well, okay, now I'm doing it. Now they get, you know, 20 pages down the road, then it clicks and they realize everything they've written is wrong for what eventually clicked, right? Take that pressure off of you. You don't need to do a daily deadline. You don't need to do a weekly deadline. It's okay if you take the next 6 months and do nothing except think and spin your wheels and feel that pain and torture yourself. It's okay because this is part of the creative process. Don't you agree?
Yeah, I mean, for our non-creative listeners, one of the things that I want to, because we do have some folks that just like to listen about how comics are made.
The
best parallel I can give this to is when, let's say Brad and I are having a disagreement conversation. We're not yelling at each other, but we're disagreeing about a topic that's important to us. But sometimes it takes going away a few days until all of a sudden you have this cogent, sharpening way of describing your position where you go back and say, Brad, remember that topic we were talking about? Let me explain it to you this way. And then you lay it out and you go, oh, I feel best about this now because I've found the cohesive idea that ties together all my points, or I found the angle of attack or angle of argument that makes it all make sense. And Brad goes, oh, all right, now I see your point, that kind of thing. So creativity is a little bit like that. You have sometimes a jumbling, stumbling way of getting your ideas out. It's like, no, it's important because, and it doesn't make sense. And then all of a sudden there's a clarifying, not all of a sudden sometimes, sometimes it's a slow dawning clarifying moment where it starts to click in and things start to make sense. And you go, oh, this is what I was really trying to say. And so I'm recognizing that I'm in that moment now, creativity wise, and I'm not sure what the final result is, but I'm trying to be kind to myself. So I'm not trying to be defensive or down on myself of like, why can't you figure this out? I'm trying to use the resources in my life. That's both people and reading materials and, you know, great thinkers that have come before in terms of creativity and trying to figure out what the next step is. And then I'm making halting steps in terms of trying out different projects that might be what I'm trying to say. And that's just either outlining things or writing down or doing first draft passes of them. And if it doesn't fit, I set them aside and you know, you be kind with yourself that you tried it and it didn't work. And knowing that it's going to take 6 months or 2 years for me to find this whatever it is that this creativity is leading me towards. And again, it's funny how when you say these things out, you a little bit sound like Susan McTaggart when you're like, and Brad, whatever the creativity is carrying me to, it's the sun shining down a light right into your heart, and you too can find the beautiful future. What I'm saying is just there is a weird jumbly moment in creativity. It's not all sunshine and roses.
Yeah.
And that sometimes you just have to be kind to yourself that the next project is waiting to happen. There is a breakthrough moment coming. It's not here yet. So be kind to yourself in the meantime and know that it is on its way with time and effort and kindness.
Yeah. You know? And that's that moment that you're walking there with your creativity down the beach and you're walking with the creativity and finally you're in a good place and you look back at the footsteps and there's only one set of footsteps and you say to your creativity, where were you during that one set of footsteps? And the creativity says, I went for a coffee.
And you say to your creativity,
you were kind of a drag.
Set of footsteps. And the creativity says, well, listen, you had a day job. You came home tired and played video games. What do you want?
The creativity says, I had a date with a much more interesting artist than you.
Listen, I was going to help you out, but Neil Gaiman called, so I went and worked on Sandman with him. So that's...
What would you do if Neil Gaiman called you? You'd leave you too.
I'm like, listen, creativity, I get it. Go hang out with Neil. That's fine.
So, Dave, we've got time for one more topic. Do you have anything you'd like to talk about?
Yes, actually, I'm glad you give me a little bit of time for this because it's stupid, but I kind of want to talk about this. I want to talk about bookstore signings because I see a lot of artists, publishers sending them on bookstore signings. For which none among us would be sad if a bookstore signing is successful. Like whenever Raina goes on a bookstore signing for Guts or Smile or anything like that, they're always immensely successful and more power to her. But I want to talk about how, for me, I feel like bookstore signings are an incredibly inefficient use of author time. And I feel like it's a remnant from an earlier day of marketing and publicity. And so junior publicists and even senior publicists for a publisher are like, well, this is the way we got to do it. We got to send them out on book signing tours.
Yeah.
And so they buy the $300 plane ticket to St. Louis. They stay at a St. Louis Marriott. They take a St. Louis cab down to the St. Louis Barnes & Noble. And then three people show up.
Yeah.
It's like, well, there's 2 days wasted for, and like, let's say even 100 people show up. How is that efficient? Like there's so many of the ways that Brad and I try to do things is if you were designing a system today, would you do it this way? Or are you doing it just because that's the way it's always been done? And I feel like bookstore signings, Brad, are a continuation of that thinking of like, well, we've always done bookstore signings, so let's just do another bookstore signing.
Yeah, bookstore signings are a thing, therefore we must do the thing.
Right, whereas to me, the word inefficient is like the operative word of what a bookstore signing is. What are your thoughts? Because I've been talking too long about it.
Take everything that I've said about comic conventions and apply it to this topic. It's an inefficient use of time. You're not getting a return on the investment. You're taking time away from doing things that are lucrative and beneficial to you. It's the same exact thing. And also substitute comic shop signings for bookstore signings. All those times that you show up, you know, I got the comic shop to host a signing, and you go there. And again, maybe if you're lucky, a dozen people show up. And if you're me, you know, 12 fewer than that show up. And it's like, why am I here? And again, take everything I said about comic conventions and apply here. Why are you doing that? Is it because you're looking for validation? Is it because you're looking for somebody to tell you're an official comic artist or an official cartoonist? Is it because you need that? If you need that, I'll tell you what, I'll do you a favor. Tap me on Twitter or get in touch with me somewhere and say, hey, Brad, am I an official cartoonist? And I'll look at you and I'll say, yes. You're an official cartoonist.
There. All right.
Yeah, no, I'm serious. If you need the validation, I'll give you the validation. I'll tell you you're official because you are. You're worth it. You're doing great. You're on your process. You don't need all this other stuff to validate yourself.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I want these to be successful for all authors. And like, listen, does it work for Lemony Snicket when he goes out? Yes, it does. Does it work for Mo Willems when he goes out to do book signings? Yes, it does. Does it work for Raina? Yes, it does. So obviously it still has value and impact for a certain type of reader, or sorry, not for a certain type of author. I just think that for beginning authors or authors in the middle of their career, it just, again, inefficiency seems like the operative word. It just feels inefficient. It feels like there is a better way to reach thousands of readers in an afternoon than taking 2 days to fly to Topeka to do a Topeka signing. And for, even if it's for 100 people, that just seems incredibly inefficient to me than other ways for an author. I mean, am I wrong here, Brad? What's a better way for an author to get out there promoting their book? Maybe that's helpful way to talk about it.
It's just about anything that they can do on social media is going to be better than a book signing. Anything that they could do to start a conversation, to share some art. There's any number of things they can do on social media that's, number one, free, and number two, has way more potential to reaching way more people. The other part is all the stuff that you're doing probably already. Your outreach on your blog. We talked about newsletters a week ago or so. Newsletters are a great way. Cultivating and then outreaching to your Patreon backers is a great way to do this. There's so many other ways, but just again, social media is, in my opinion, the key here. And the way you make that work isn't saying, hey, here's my book. Click this link to go to this other place that's going to take you off the social media to go look at that book. That's horrible. Social media is all about sharing your joy. And the operative words there are sharing and joy. Number one, you share something about that thing that you're promoting, your book or whatever. Here's a page that I'm really excited about because XYZ happens. That's something I can see, on the social media that you're putting it on. I don't have to go someplace else for it. And B, you've given me a reason to care about it because you're sharing your joyfulness over it. Hey, look at this. Here's something that I did in panel two that I'm really excited about. I want to share with you.
Yep.
That kind of stuff gets shared. That kind of stuff gets engagement. Time-lapse videos on Instagram particularly and on Twitter. Here's my process in a minute. You know, sped up, zoop-a-doop-a-doop-a-doop-a-doop, done. And what I found is starting and ending with that finished image. Wow, does that get incredible engagement. And the more you engage people, the more you're getting people to follow you on social media, the more people that are there when you say, hey, the new book is out and it's over here. Go get it. I'm super excited to share it with you. And you've built your audience there, and they will be there for it because they like you. They've liked engaging with you. Don't you agree?
I agree, and this is a perfect point to end the show and say, go over to newevilbook.com and engage with the new pins.
Yes!
How about that?
You are Johnny Transition over there.
Johnny Transition. So just a reminder, all the Patreon backers can go over to patreon.com/comiclab and get the secret links either to Brad's store or to my store to get the two pins for $10 as our special thank you for Patreon backers. And by all means, join us over on Patreon if that entices you as the one thing that pushes you over the edge to supporting the show and becoming a Patreon backer.
Yes.
But you can either go to newevilbook.com or sheldonstore.com to get the new pin. And I think you're going to be delighted by them.
Oh,
I think you're going to be delighted.
Wait till you see them. They're going to be great. And then you, too, will be able to say that you've been listening to Comic Lab, the show about making comics and making a living from comics.
Your hosts have been my friend Brad Geiger, the editor of webcomics.com and the cartoonist of Evil Inc. at evil-comic.com.
And my friend Dave Kellett, co-director of Stripped and cartoonist of Sheldon at sheldoncomics.com and Drive at drivecomic.com.
This week's show and all the shows carrying us through the rest of 2019, sponsored by the good folks over at Wacom, WACOM.com. Go check them out. And the Comic Lab theme song is used with permission from Andy Creighton at theworldrecord.net. And this episode and all episodes was edited by the ever-delightful Matt Woodard of Woodsong Productions over at www.woodsong.media.
Comic Lab is made possible by your support on patreon.com/comiclab, so we'll go ahead and say that twice. patreon.com/comiclab. I've got no stinger for the end of the show, Dave. Do you want to just sing something? they seem to love it when we sing.